set time to be holy. Speak of with thy Lord. Abide in him always, and feed on his word. Make friends of God's children. Help those who are weak, forgetting in nothing his blessing to seek. Take time to be holy. The world rushes on. Spend much time in secret with Jesus alone. By looking to Jesus, like him thou shalt be. Thy friends in thy conduct his likeness shall see. Take time to be holy. Let him be thy guide, and run not before him, whatever betide, in joy or in sorrow. Still follow thy Lord, and looking to Jesus, still trust in his word. Take time to be holy. Be calm in thy soul. Each thought and each temper beneath his control. Thus, led by his Spirit, the fountains of love, thou shalt soon be fitted for service above.
There is a mixed language that is coming up among the women. I've been trying to make things clear to ensure that we are not just going by revelation but by the Bible. The revelation we receive are the ones that the Bible confirms. What we will use to enforce a truth is not revelation, but the Bible. Revelations only serve to justify scriptural truth already specified in the Bible. One, it is unbiblical to say women should cut their hair. That is unrighteousness. It's contrary to the teaching of the Bible. In the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 11, not 10, I read from verse 3, but I would have you know that the head of every man is Christ, and the head of the woman is the man, and the head of Christ is God. Every man praying or prophesying, having his head covered, dishonored his head. But every woman that prayeth or prophesieth with her head uncovered dishonoreth her head. For that is even all one as if she were shaven, as if she cut her hair. For if the woman be not covered, let her also be shorn, let the hair be cut off, let her also be shorn. But if it is a shame for a woman to be shorn or shaven, let her be covered. But if it is a shame, in those days, according to scriptural history, or according to the history, a woman caught in adultery would have her hair shaved so she could appear with her shaven hair before the public and be identified as a woman that had committed adultery. So it is a shame. because something had affected her. Something had affected her. So the long hair in a woman's head is her glory. The long hair in a woman's head is her glory. The Bible tells us in that same scripture in verse 14, doth not even nature itself teach you that if a man have long hair, it is a shame unto him? The woman with low hair, cut hair, shaven hair, is a shame to her. The man with long hair, it is a shame to him. Verse 15, but if a woman have long hair, it is a glory to her. For her hair is given her for a covering. If a woman have long hair, it is a glory to her. It gives description to the woman, definition to the woman. It gives femininity to the woman. She's feminine. That's the long hair shows this is a woman. You identify her by that, the long hair. You identify the man with the short hair, even by nature. To come and tell women to come to short hair is to introduce them to what the Bible calls shame. It's also to bring them to masculine hairdo, because it is the man that short hair is recommended for, not the woman. It is the man that short hair is recommended for. It is the man that is discouraged from keeping long hair, and the man is told that it is feminine to have long hair. It is womanish. Long hair is womanish. It shows forth a woman, gives her her glory, gives her her beauty. That is why to get this cosmetic beauty, this artificial beauty, the women have to fabricate other ways in which they can have long hair. Get attachment, get wool to increase it, to enlarge it, because the hair, her glory is in her hair. So it's natural for a woman. Hair has been her problem from the very first, because she considers her beauty to be in her hair, and as a result, for holiness sake, the scripture has to do a lot with her hair, warning over her hair. So to say Jesus Christ is saying women should cut their hair is to tell a lie against Jesus. The Jesus who has recommended long hair to the woman cannot recommend that the woman cut her hair and go with a bad hair. Jesus, who says, I gave the hair, the long hair, to the woman for her glory, will not want to deface her, will not want to bring her to shame. So that is what we understand. But if a woman had destroyed her hair by palming, said, because my hair has been tempered with, I will have to cut off the pumped hair to allow the new one grow. Beautiful. That is in the spirit of righteousness. And that is temporal. Waiting for when it will grow back and you go to your feminine hairdressing. And in that case, therefore, if you are going out, if you are praying, if you are going out where people will see you in the world, you cover that hair, because the short hair is not your hair. It's not the way the Lord recommends you to have to dress. You're putting on a masculine appearance. Is that understood? You are putting on a masculine appearance by wearing short hair. It's not yours. Somebody said, I think what causes many women to want to leave their hair that way is because they say, I want to bob my hair because it's too tough for me to comb. It's too tough for me to plait. It's too tough for me for this. Since I can't go to saloon again to go and relax my hair, to go and pump my hair, the best thing is to cut it. There is natural solution to take and maintain the cause of God. Natural solution. When we were in Warri, one of the sisters there said, olive oil can soften the hair. There is the grace of God. They have used olive hair and the hair became soft. Olive oil, please. Olive oil. I don't want to call it anointing oil. Otherwise you say, so let's go and anoint our hair. Because every time I go under anointing. No. Everyone say olive oil.
Olive oil.
Say it again.
Olive oil.
The third time. You know olive oil?
Yes.
So I'm told that you could apply that and it's natural oil. It's not cosmetic. You could apply that and you'll find that your hair will become soft. You can walk on your hair. So, with this now, we understand it is not the teaching of this movement that women should cut their hair. Those people who originated those teaching have no knowledge of the scripture. Some will say, Jesus told me. We must be careful because Satan knows that revelation is working. And the best way to confuse the church of God and divide them is to bring many voices and say they are from Jesus. A woman was telling me today, when she had in the TV, you know, holiness movement now is on my TV. About 5:30 on Monday, 5:30 on Friday, you can watch the programs of holiness movement on my TV. Amen. So a woman who listened to one such program, the program of yesterday, said, phoned me this morning and said, is it Jesus that said earring is not good? Because that Jesus told her that he gave people message to preach. But they left his message and started preaching against earring. And started preaching against dressing with gold, dressing flamboyant. That he wants his children to dress like kings. I told her that there are two types of Jesus. Are you hearing me? There is Christ. There is also Antichrist. So, there is angel. There is one that transformed as angel of light. So Satan will want to come in using this revelation as a means to confuse the people and divide it. That's why if we go only on revelation, there's no hope. It will be scattered by another revelation of the devil. We go on the Bible. Is that okay? Now comes to, do you use thread? In the book of 1 Timothy, chapter 2, verse 9 and 10. In like manner also, that women adorn themselves in modest apparel, with shamefacedness and sobriety, not with braided hair, or gold, or pearls, or costly array, which becometh women professing godliness with good works. I want you to look at verse 10. Verse 10 says, verse 9 forbids something, verse 10 recommends something. Verse 9 forbids something, verse 10 recommends something. Verse 10, what is the recommendation of verse 10? But which becometh, which is suitable, which is appropriate for women professing godliness. What verse 10 is recommending in the womanish dressing is that which is appropriate of women professing godliness. Costly array, for example, how much? How much cloth are you to put on? It's not specified. But what is clearly specified is that which is suitable for women that profess godliness. You can find wrappers of 700 naira. You can find wrappers of 1,000. You can find for 1,005. You can find for 2,000. You can find for 3,000, 5,000, 6,000, 12,000, 15,000. You come to for 50,000, 70,000, 100,000. The Bible only says costly array. What should you not buy any cloth that is beyond 1,000 naira? The question now comes, if you put it on, will it affect your godliness before the people? Will people see a sign in you that there's ungodliness? How will the society read you when you put on that cloth? I cannot buy any cloth of 3,000. That would be too costly. Is that so? Okay. If you put on that cloth, what will the society say? Would they look at you as being proud? Would they look at you as being high-minded? Because what the Bible is trying to avoid here is anything that will corrupt your righteousness. That your humility will be corrupted. Anything that will affect you yourself, anything that will cause the people to murmur against you, does not nature itself teach you? What is that nature? The comments of people around, the observation of people around, and the circumstance surrounding the matter. Does not even nature itself teach you? So, that which becometh women professing godliness. In this way, therefore, we come to the withering of the hair, which people are talking about. Should women braid? Should the women weave their hair? There is the braiding that is ungodly, which worldly women do, which when you see them, you know that it is of the spirit of the world. But there is that which becometh women professing godliness, which has nothing to do with the fashion of this world. Are we getting what I'm saying? It has nothing to do with the fashion of this world. It does not affect the person who has done it. It does not affect the society. It has nothing to do with the fashion of this world. Satan's business is not there. Satan's business is not there. He does not take glory in it at all. It is not an attraction, attracting people to it. It does not produce a center of attraction in your hairdo. It is not for beauty's sake, but only the dressing, a way of dressing your hair. And that weaving of hair, which people do, helps to keep the hair of the women long. Is that okay? Without doing that, leaving your hair like that, you cannot achieve this long hair that the Bible says is a glory to the woman. It's a natural hair. You don't do anything to it. By the natural dressing of it, you can now have the long hair that gives the woman her glory. Are you understanding? But the same method can be, the people of the world use various ways on this hair, that to achieve beauty according to the fashion of this world, according to the spirit of the power of the air, the spirit that now works on the children of disobedience. They are the harlots. They are the harlots, the prostitutes, the wayward, the backsliders that follow the flesh, that walk according to the dictates of the flesh. When they do their hair, you will know them, for you shall know them by their fruits. Is that clear? So, that which normal woman does, becometh women professing godliness, that does not affect Christianity, the Lord is not fighting you. God is not fighting you. The microphone is used to achieve evil. The microphone is used to achieve good. But we shall know them. When the microphone is being used to bring forth the glory of the Lord, you can see. And when it is being used to promote Satan, you can also see. Is that okay? So, when someone says, no, leave your hair like that, it will not achieve the long hair that God says he has given the woman long hair for her glory. It will not achieve it. Long natural hair, not long artificial hair. The Lord is fighting the artificial hair. So, braided hair stands for a world. It's a word that stands for all corruption of the hair, which changes from one style to another with generations. Is that clear? In the time of writing, there were various flamboyant style in which they braid their hair down to their back, fixing some gold things, golden property, to cause the hair to be attractive, cause the hair to be glorious. As you could see, if you go to Revelation chapter 17, the mother harlot had her dressing. So all these corrupt ones are the daughters of the harlot, dressing to attract, to promote immorality, to project beauty. It shows your corrupt heart, and it is a direct abuse to the word of God. So, braided hair therefore stands for any corrupt hairdo. Any hairdo that is after the fashion of the world. Any hairdo that comes from beauty promotion. Any hairdo that comes from the inspiration of Satan. If you bring it to that of man, any haircut that is after the fashion of this world, any haircut style, they call some J5, Pong, what again? Shattered, Dagger, Okay, the one that look like lizard. When you see that, don't you recognize that it is evil? Natural. In the same way, when you look at the woman in her hairdressing, you know the one that is of the devil. But you know the one that is normal, part of normal dressing. No evil is attached to it. Just as you see in the hell, hear do of me. The emphasis is hear do that it should not be worldly style. Not that which is not becoming of women professing godliness. Is that okay? Now come to 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 3. Verse 1 to verse 5. Likewise, ye wives, be in subjection to your own husbands, that if any obey not the word, they also may without the word be won by the conversation of the wives, while they behold your chaste conversation coupled with fear, whose adorning. Stop there. What is Peter talking about, and whom is Peter talking to? He is talking about husbands, family relationship at home. Whom is he talking to? To wives. Christian wives. That's the people Peter is talking to. To Christian wives. What is he talking about? About their submission to their husband. About their winning their husband to Christ. That's what Peter is talking about. Get the foundation well. About winning their husbands to Jesus. In winning your husband to Jesus, Peter is advising the woman, instructing the woman, commanding the woman. He is saying, not in your effort to win your husband, to win the heart of your husband to yourself, to Christ. If you really want to win that man, who may be an unbeliever, don't. There are the don'ts. There are the do's. What are the don'ts? He presented three don'ts. He presented one do. Three things don't do. Because you want to win your husband. One thing, do. It will help you to win your husband by the grace of God. Now, one, whose adorning? Your own making yourself fine looking. Whose dressing? Let it not be that outward adorning. Don't seek to impress your husband or think you will win him by any external decoration. Whose adorning? Let it not be that outward adorning of plaiting the hair and of wearing of gold or of putting on of apparel condemned, but what is justified. But let it be the hidden man of the heart, in that which is not corruptible, even the ornament of a meek and quiet spirit, which is in the sight of God of great price. These other ones are not of in the sight of God of any worthy value. But the heart of righteousness, meekness, humility, quiet spirit, not making trouble, is in the sight of God of great price. Use that on your husband. Use your godly character on your husband. If you go at and paying attention to the externals, externals will fade away to be corrupted. Now, come back to that scripture. Whose adorning? Now, let's come to verse 5. For after this manner, in the old time, the holy women also, who trusted in God, did what? Adorned themselves, being in subjection unto their own husbands. Can you see? It's woman, husband. Woman, husband. Take your mind off and come to the present generation. The woman in our generation that wants to embrace her husband, to get her husband to herself in our generation, what are the types of clothes she will use? Eh? You say? Trousers or trousers. Why? Because they preach in some churches. Your husband, these girls are dressing like that to attract your husband. Therefore, to be able to snatch your husband from them, dress in the same way. They wear trousers, short skirts, short gown, so that their body should be exposed. In this way, their husbands, instead of feasting on the exposed body of women on the street, they should now come and feast on their body, and then their husband will be safe. Have you heard this type of preaching before? That's what is going on now. The painting that women are painting outside to look beautiful, and they are attracting your husband's eye. Paint and get this husband for yourself. So that is what the Bible is rebuking. Women, don't do that. Don't go to these fashions of the world because you think that you can get your husband to love you by that. Because you think you can get your husband to appreciate you by that. Don't do that. So, when it comes to what he is meeting, outward beauty of the plaiting of the hair. Come again. And of the putting on of wearing of gold. And of the putting on of apparel. If you check, let's pick it from the putting on of apparel. The putting on of apparel means what? The putting on of clothes. What is apparel? What is apparel? Clothes. The putting on of clothes. The plaiting of the hair. The putting on of clothes. Now, is he saying then, women should not put on clothes? Huh? Don't join these women outside there on the street who put on every kind of cloth to impress people, to attract people to themselves. Some of these worldlings do so and say they want to attract their husbands. Don't join them. So, the putting on of clothes now is not talking about not wearing clothes, but not wearing clothes that is not suitable for righteous women. Is that okay? Not wearing the clothes that is not suitable for righteous women. Not putting on the dress that is not glorifying God. Not putting on the dress that is not glorifying God because you think that you want to influence your husband. Don't do that. Then come back to the plaiting of the hair. The same. Does it mean don't plait your hair? No. It is saying don't have the hairdo as you see in the fashions of the world because you want to influence your husband. You want to promote external out what duty to influence your husband, it will not work. Don't join the styles of the world, the fashions of the world. Don't go into the hairdo that is not suitable for women professing godliness. Don't go into the hairdo that is unrighteous. God condemns such. Is that okay? Don't go into the hairdo that is unrighteous. It does not say don't use tray to pack your hair. That's hairdressing. It's not what it's talking about. Don't use thread to pack your hair. Don't use the thread after the fashion of the people of the world, who employ every kind of thing. Every kind of thing, because their aim is their hair. Don't join that. If you are plaiting your hair, it should be suitable, appropriate for women professing godliness. That which is not because you want to give attention to it, no, but as a means of dressing. If you are putting on cloth, it's not just because you want to make a show of yourself, no, but as a means of dressing. Is that okay? Now, in this wise, therefore, there's some manufacturers, designs, products that come out into the world that have to be carefully designed to ensure they are not coming from Satan, to achieve, to cause this drive for beauty, the drive for beauty, the fashion of the world. Some women have observed that the robber trade of this present generation, of this present time, have their own design, look different. It makes the woman to design every style, fashionable style, on her hair, and still achieve the same thing of attraction to her hair. Are you getting it now? That in a distance, you see the woman coming from there, the sun is reflecting on her hair. And that is not suitable for women professing godliness. I will listen to your observation. Are you getting it now? Because the Bible says strong meat belongs to them, the strong thing belongs to them that are of age, who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. There are people that have gone into spiritual discipline, exercise their mind, and God helps them. They are quick to discern the hand of the devil in some things. So some women therefore are mentioning that this robber trade, not all trades, this robber trade that is now in our time, is having a property of beauty, attraction, that tempts the woman, leads the woman to designing various things. That makes it, there's no difference between it and attachment. So, that one is coming as being a vital information for women professing godliness, because your dressing at all times must show for the glory of God, must not be to buy beauty to impress anyone. Now, there's still the second one, whose adorning, let it not be that outward adorning of plaiting the hair and of wearing of gold. There are people who will now say, yes, we should not just give emphasis, not that we should not do it at all. We should not just give emphasis to these things. If we complain, but not to do it in the style of the world, not to be worldly, if we can put on clothes, but not to do it in the style of the world, then we can also wear jewelry. It's only we don't go to the excess of it. Now, we have to understand it in the balance. Is there any scripture anywhere that tells us about plaiting the hair that will give us added meaning to this scripture? That word appears in no place. That word does not appear in any place. Is there any scripture that appears somewhere else on apparel that can help us understand the mind of God of what is said here? Yes. We saw that Tamar, the daughter-in-law to Judah, put on the apparel, the cloth of a harlot, of a prostitute. Then, this wearing of apparel is warning against the dressing of prostitutes. Is that clear? It's warning against evil dressing, which can tempt people to immorality. It's warning against, if you check other portions of scripture, how the kings will array himself, Herod arrayed himself in a royal apparel, in a great apparel. It's talking about the dressing that promotes pride. Avoid that. But then what about the wearing of gold? Is there other scripture that talk about this gold? So we can understand what the mind of God is. From the Old Testament to the New Testament, the issue of gold has been won. Is it to use moderately? No. Not for moderate use. In the book of Genesis chapter 35, verse 1 to verse 4, and God said unto Jacob, arise, go up to Bethel and dwell there, and make there an altar unto God that appeared unto thee when thou fleddest from the face of Esau thy brother. And Jacob said unto his household and to all that were with him, put away the strange gods that are among you, and be clean, and change your garments. Change your garments. This is talking about apparel, which means this apparel the Lord is talking about is the type of garment that you cannot wear when you are dealing with the Lord. Jacob said, those should be changed. Change your garments. The Lord has asked me to come to consecrate unto him. And these clothes you are wearing cannot serve the Lord. These clothes cannot serve the Lord. Change them. So, that's what we are saying. Don't wear clothes that cannot serve the Lord. Polluted clothes, or clothes that make you flamboyant and great and fills you with pride, you cannot serve the Lord. Where instead of people seeing God in you, they are seeing your clothes. Don't do that. Be simple. Now, change your garment. This is corrupt cloth here. Now, again in verse 4, verse 3. And let us arise and go up to Bethel, and I will make there an altar unto God, who answered me in the day of my distress, and was with me in the way which I went. And they gave unto Jacob all the strange gods which were in their hands. And what again? And all their earrings which were in their ears. And Jacob hid them under the oak which was by Shechem. No moderation here. Gave them all out. Long ones, short ones, wide ones, black ones, white ones, red ones, flat ones, shaped, corner-shaped ones, whichever can, all. No type is recommended for Christian woman. For those who want to serve God, no kind is recommended. So, that scripture, not of God, is not moderation. Remove it completely. Then, in the book of Exodus, chapter 33, Exodus, chapter 33, we read, verse 4 to verse 6. And when the people heard this evil tidings, they mourned, and no man did put on him his ornaments. For the Lord had said unto Moses, say unto the children of Israel, ye are a stiff-necked people. I will come up into the midst of thee in a moment and consume thee. Therefore now, put off thy ornaments from thee, that I may know what to do unto thee. And the children of Israel stripped themselves of their ornaments by the Mount Horeb. Total cleansing. Stiff-necked people. Remove those things that you put on for your external beauty. Remove them. Stubborn people. And they were totally cleansed. So, not of God, not moderation. Because the revelation of scripture on God, which, what is this God? Numbers chapter 31. Numbers chapter 31. We read verse 50 and 51. Are you there? We want to talk about this God. When they say not of God, in Exodus they are called ornaments. Here they are called God. What are they? Verse 50. The Bible says, we have therefore brought an oblation for the Lord. What every man had gotten of jewels of gold. What are they? Number one is what? Jewels of gold. When they talk about gold, number one is what? Chains. Number two? Bracelets. Number three? Rings. Number four? Earrings. Number five? Tablets is necklace. Then you also continue in that fashion to have the nose rings. You now come to have ornaments of the leg, where they beautify their leg by putting some gold things in the leg. So these things are ornaments which the Lord commanded that put them off from your life. Not moderation. Remove them. Strip themselves means total removal. Complete removal of these things. So, not of God. From other scriptures, that phrase means never anything to do with God. Because their origin is of the sinful world. And they are items of idolatry. They are items of promoting beauty, ornamentation. These things, these are the things. And the Lord said, get them off. Completely. But the plating of the hair is not idolatrous. There's no place that traces it to idolatry. No. It's womanish hairdressing, which a Christian woman does. It's very simple. As a way of hairdressing. The way putting on of apparel is not idolatrous. There is the idolatrous part of it, which Jacob told his people, change your garments. That's the idolatrous part of it. The one that is sinful, the one that is evil, is the one to be changed. But the normal part, because a normal human being must wear clothes. That normal one, healthy one, that gives you Christian godly appearance, because you must not be naked to destroy the glory of God in the congregation. To tempt other people to sin. You must not be naked. You should cover your nakedness. So, that is what scripture is saying. Not of God there. Again, in verse 5 of that first Peter chapter 3, in verse 5, the Bible tells us, they're saying, for after this manner, in the old time, the holy women also, who trusted in God, adorned themselves. Take it. After this manner, the holy women also, who trusted in God in the old time, adorned themselves. Did the holy women wear gold? No. The Lord had instructed that no puncture, no mark should be done to this body. No mark. The puncturing of your ear is a trespass against the God that made this temple. Don't you know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit? When he made that woman, did he puncture the ear? When the baby girl is coming from the womb, is she coming with a punctured ear? So, you are defacing that body. You are affecting that body by puncturing it. That house is not your house. You didn't build it. You're living there on rent. Somebody else rented that house that you're calling your home. Can you put windows where you want to put windows? Can you put doors where you want to put doors? Will that be accepted? It's a trespass against the owner of that house that built it according to plan. He built that house according to plan and according to the tests of his heart. You cannot put window where you want window to be. Because I'm the one living here. You're the one living there, but were you the one that built it? The one that built it is greater than the one that is living there. So, after this manner, the holy women of old adorned themselves. If they were having hairdo, completely devoid of worldliness, completely devoid of evil, but they never used gold. They never hung earring in their ears. They didn't do it. Why? They will be transgressing the word of God that commanded them not to have any mark, any kind of puncture, any kind of mark upon their body. So, holy women never use those things. So, come to the dressing of the holy women. And what type of apparel did the holy women use? The one that was suitable for women professing godliness. The one that was appropriate, adequate for women who the society will count holy. That when they are seen, they will see them with holiness. Identified with holiness. That is what the women use. Now, the last one. For after this manner, also, the holy women who trusted in God adorned themselves. The last sentence there is, last clause or last phrase, being in subjection unto their own husbands. Your dressing and subjection to your husband, they speak together. If you go flamboyant, you are advertising yourself. That which is advertised on the wayside is not for one man. Is that understood? That which is advertised. If you advertise your hair by the fashion of hairdo, you are advertising yourself. You are not for your husband alone. Other people will be interested. Is that clear? All this gold that the people use, what are they using them for? For beauty. To make themselves great and beautiful. If you are now putting on this gold, this chain, this ring, this to make yourself gorgeous, you are advertising yourself. And that which is advertised is not for one man. Others will be interested. If your wearing of clothes is for beauty and greatness, that is where your attention is. That's where you get the type of clothes you get and sew the type of styles you sew. Then, and if you wear this thing according to the fashion of the people of the world, you are not for one man. The woman who is on trousers is not affecting her husband alone. She is pulling on every other person. The woman who is on mini skirt is not for her husband alone. As long as you come to the open field, you are not for your husband alone. And because of your dressing, harlotry will follow. People step you. Flies will come, for ants are attracted to where there's something sweet. It will affect you. The holy women of all time did not give attention to this beauty thing you're doing, because beauty is vain. It is the woman that feareth the Lord that shall be praised. And to such a woman, her husband shall be known at the gate, and her husband shall call her blessed. Is that clear? Not for this beautiful dressing. So, dress godly and submit yourself to your husband, that when people see you on the street, they see a reasonable woman that has the husband's authority over her by her simplicity in appearance, by her maturity in dressing. They see the glory of God in her modesty, and they see also her husband behind her. And such a woman is cursed for you to be approaching for immorality. Is difficult. Is that okay? Do we now understand the language of the Bible? Do we now understand the spirit of the Bible? That is the righteousness God needs from you so that you can go to heaven. Let's not go on running to the left. It's okay, all women should cut their hair. You cut down your hair. All women, don't use straight anymore. You are running up and down. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. And let that man not think that he shall receive anything from the Lord. Are we getting it now? So, let's be very careful. If you have, maybe you are in holiness movement, you say you have dreamed a dream. This is not company of dreamers. They are company of those that are looking for righteousness. And the interpretation of these dreams is not left to you. It's not left to you. You cannot, there are many people who dream and they cannot interpret it. If you force interpretation to that dream, you will scatter righteousness. Are you hearing me? Again, the Bible says, when Belshazzar saw handwriting on the wall, who could interpret it? He called all the magicians, and none could. Anybody could come to interpret, but then they said, there's a man in your kingdom. His name is Daniel. With him is the spirit of wisdom and knowledge, and interpretation of dreams and heart sentences. Let Daniel be called, and he will interpret this. And the Bible tells us, study to make yourself approved unto God, a watchman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. You who don't know Bible, you are giving interpretation to dreams. How will you get correct interpretations? Do you know the Bible? If you feel you have received a message, seek those who know the Bible to put your messages well, to know where you understood it rightly, where you didn't understand it rightly, where your language of expression is immature, that you'll be affecting the people of God, who will be saying, hey, Jesus met with him, Jesus talked to him, Jesus is the one who said it all, that all the women should cut their hair now, Jesus is the one who said it all. And you are causing trouble in the churches of Christ with your, and you don't know God. You don't know scripture. Even some of them are unbelievers that Jesus appeared to. Will you be running to such people for interpretation? Hey, what did Jesus say? Hey, what did he say? Tell me now, let me run quickly. You will run to where? You will run to darkness. Be stable in your life. What makes us approved to God is not just that we accept revelation, but we stand on the Bible, balancing revelation with the Bible. Give a clap offering to Jesus. Thank you. God bless you.
Miss message you have just listened to is a production of Holiness Revival Movement Worldwide. Holiness Revival Movement Worldwide is a non-denominational ministry that is given to the propagation of Christ's righteousness and holiness in churches and nations of the world through crusades, revival meetings, production and spread of holiness literature and materials. For other spiritual materials, messages, or inquiry, contact us on 0813-635-6813 and 0805-683-4323. You can also reach us through our email address, holinessrevivalmovement@gmail.com. God bless you.